Saints, as we continue in our worship service today, this is the time when we just ask the Lord to use the offering that the saints have presented before Him. There's a scripture that has impressed my heart here. It's Psalm 111. And verse 1 says, "Praise ye the Lord. I will praise the Lord with my whole heart, in the assembly of the upright and in the congregation. The works of the Lord are great, sought out of all them who have pleasure therein. His work is honorable and glorious, and his righteousness endureth forever. He hath made his wonderful works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion." The Lord is gracious and full of compassion. Lord, as we acknowledge our offerings to you this morning, we thank you that your works are to be remembered, and Lord, that you are gracious and that you are full of compassion. Lord, that we have been recipients of your grace and compassion. And so, Lord, we ask that as we come before you today, that you would bless this offering that has come in through the mail or has been given online. Lord, we realize as we look back to the Old Testament that the Israelites brought their offerings to the tabernacle and to the temple. And Lord, they were sanctified and used in your service. And so, Lord, we're unable to come to the sanctuary, but we still want to offer up our offerings to you as an act of worship. And we pray, Lord, that it would be a sweet smell of incense in your nostrils. And we thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us. And we just ask that you would help us in some small way to be able to give back to you. And we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Good morning, saints. As we come today, I think about a song that I like to use to introduce our message today. Many of you may have heard this song. Some of you, you know, if you're old school, I'm sure you heard of it. If you're not, then I'll try to explain it to you. But there was a guy and his girlfriend, and they were breaking up. And as they broke up, one of the things that the guy said to the young lady is he said, "I'll always be around." He said, given the fact that we are breaking up, that we're not going to be a couple no more, I just want to let you know, whenever you call me, I'll be there. Whenever you need me, I'll be there. Whenever you want me, I'll be there. I'll be around. And you know, that's a high and lofty promise that this guy was making. But you know, the problem with what he was saying was the fact that one day he was going to leave this earth. One day he was going to close his eyes in death. And so that promise that he made would be null and void. I want to tell you this morning about a God who said, whenever you need me, I'll be there. Whenever you want me, I'll be there. Whenever you call me, I'll be there. I'll be around. Today we're talking and continuing on with the El names of God. And today we're going to talk about El Olam, the God, the everlasting God. You see, the guy in the song, he made a promise. And I'm sure that in the moment, the promise was sincere. But he wasn't always going to be around to fulfill that promise. We're talking about the God of eternity this morning that will always be around to fulfill each and every promise that he makes. Before we continue in the message today, I want to share a song with you. And the name of the song goes right along with the title of the message today, The Everlasting God. The Everlasting God. Take a listen to this song, and we'll come back and continue talking about El Olam.
Yeah. reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not fade, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak, you comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. From everlasting to everlasting, God, you are
amen. The everlasting God. I love that song because, you know, it talks about God, and it says that you are the everlasting God. You don't faint and you don't grow weary, that you are the everlasting God. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up like wings on an eagle. You are the everlasting God. El Olam, the everlasting God. You remember we talked about this word El. Now, we went over all the Yahweh names of God back in 2020. So we've started talking about the El names of God. And so the El names of God deal with the power of God. That word El, it actually refers to mighty, power, strength. And so when we take that word El and we couple it with other words, it talks about the power of God. So far, we've looked at El Elyon, the Most High God. Last week, we looked at El Shaddai, the Almighty, the All-Sufficient God. Today, we are looking at El Olam, the Everlasting God. We're going to look at El Ohim, the All-Powerful God, and El Roy, the God who sees me. Now, when we look at the word Olam, again, we've taken that El word, right? The El word, E-L, the power, the might of God. We've taken that word and we've coupled it with another word, which is Olam. Now, what does Olam mean? Well, actually, Olam means that which is hidden, concealed, or unknown. That which is hidden, concealed, or unknown. So that might be a little confusing, right? When we think of, well, how can that connect with the name of God? Well, when we look at this word, Olam, it deals with something that is hidden to the human mind, something that is concealed. Like we can't begin to think about the fact that God is everlasting. That blows our minds to even try to wrap our head around the fact that God is everlasting. And so it's actually hidden from our understanding. We can never understand that. We can never grasp that. That is actually concealed from us being able to understand the totality of what that means. Let me explain to you. Maybe this will help you out. I remember one night I was lying in bed and I began to think, where did God come from? Right? And I said, well, who put God here? And I came up with the answer. I came up with the answer of who put God here. I said there was another God who put God here. But then I compounded my problem because now I had to answer the question, where did that God come from? Right? So I began to say, well, another God put that God here. And, you know, that thing just began to mushroom. And actually, you know, I kept going back that there must have been a God who put that God here. And finally, I think I almost went crazy that night trying to figure out how God got here. And I came to the conclusion that he's always been here. Right? He's always been here. And why do we know that? Because he's what? El Olam, the God, the everlasting God. That there has never been a time when God was not. That he existed in eternity past, he will continue to exist in eternity future. Now, we often use the phrase the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Now, I know that those are biblical terms because we read them throughout the Bible, especially in the book of Revelation. We read about the Alpha and Omega. It says, you know, Jesus is the Alpha, Omega, beginning and the end, the first and the last. And you know what? I don't question Scripture. I accept Scripture by faith. But I began to think and say, well, I got a little issue with that, because if we say that he's the Alpha, then that means that he started somewhere, right? If we say that he's the Omega, that means that he ends somewhere. You know, the word Alpha was the first letter in the Greek alphabet. The word Omega was the last letter in the Greek alphabet. So, in essence, and so I when we look at that, you know, I take it that Scripture is looking and using that as a hyperbole. And so, you know, what is a hyperbole? You know, that's where we, you know, kind of exaggerate or under-exaggerate the whole idea. And so, you know, they've used this phrase Alpha and Omega, you know, to represent, you know, the beginning and the end. But yet and still, God had no beginning. He had no beginning. He has no ending. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. We serve El Olam. And as we go through the message a little bit later, I'm going to tell you specifically what that means to us. You know, it's one thing to know that he's El Olam, but what I want to know is, what does that mean to me? How does that affect my life? How does that make my living better? How am I strengthened in this walk that I have with God when I understand who he is, El Olam? Well, God created time, yet he exists outside of time. He created time, but he exists outside of time. Listen to Psalm 90, verses 1 and 2. Lord, you have been our refuge in every generation. Before the mountains were brought forth, or before the mountains were born, before you gave birth to the earth and the world, from eternity to eternity, you are El Olam. You are, that's what it says in there. Now we know that it says you are God, but what name is represented there? The name that's represented is El Olam. Lord, you have been our dwelling place. You have been our refuge in every generation. Before the mountains were born, before you gave birth to the earth and the world, from everlasting, from eternity to eternity, you are El Olam. I like what Warren Wiersbe says about Psalm 90 in verse 12. Warren Wiersbe was one of the great Bible teachers in this country. For years, he was on Back to the Bible. And he came on every night, Monday through Friday, and he would exegete scripture. So he was a great Bible expositor, a great Bible teacher. Warren Wiersbe says this: first, there were sundials. Then came water clocks, hourglasses, mechanical clocks. Now we have digital clocks and watches that split time into hundreds of seconds. Our culture certainly is concerned with time. Just think about it. You know, we praise God, we have some saints that have come today to be a part of this taping and to hear the word of God. And, you know, they were told to come at 4 o'clock, right? And so when you think about that, time is very important. That, you know, you're going to meet somebody tomorrow at time. So we as individuals, that we put a lot of emphasis on time. The psalmist said, Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. God knows no time. Yo, God doesn't look at his watch and say, at 3 o'clock, I'm going to do this. Yo, God doesn't say, tomorrow at 12, I'm going to do this. God does not operate in time. You know, I think of Jesus Christ, right? Here Jesus Christ, you know, he was in eternity past. He existed in eternity past. He's going to exist in eternity future. And so here he has this eternal existence, and he was called on to come, be born, to live his life and die on a cross, and then go back to heaven. What did Jesus do? Jesus was in eternity, right? And he stepped out of eternity and did what? Stepped into time. Yeah. He stepped into time. He lived in time. He did what he was supposed to do. And then when he ascended back into heaven, he stepped out of time and he stepped back into eternity. The everlasting God. And so God, who is the creator of time, is not restricted by the time that he created. That God has always been. So I scratched my head, as I told you earlier, to try to figure out how God got here. And I came to the conclusion that he's always been here. There's never been a time when he was not here. As a matter of fact, let me get a little scientific on you, and I'm going to make it real simple. I'm going to get scientific, but I'm going to make it simple. He is the uncaused first cause of everything. What are you saying, Pastor Glaze? That means that God got here without a cause. Nobody caused God to happen. God just was here. He just existed. But yet and still, he's what? He's the first cause of everything else. If you look around, all these things got here because God put them here in some shape or form. So even though he's uncaused, even though there was nothing that caused him to come into existence, that he always was, yet and still, he is the first cause of everything else. When you think about evolution, evolution says that we all originated out of a pool of slime. But my question is, and I don't believe in evolution, but my question is, if there was a pool of slime that the evolutionists said that we came out of, y'all know where I'm going. You know where I'm going. Who put the pool of slime here? How did the pool of slime get here? I tell the story often about some evolutionists who challenged God to a contest. And they said, Let's see who can make the best man. And so God started, and God reached down into the earth, and he created a man out of the dust of the earth. And then God blew the breath of life into this man, and the man began to live. The man stood up, the man began to walk around, and the man began to enjoy life. And the evolutionist said, oh, that's pretty good, but let us go to work. And so they reached down into the dirt, and God said, ho, wait a minute. Get your own dirt. get your own dirt, right? But see, God is the one who put the dirt here, right? He's the uncaused, first cause of everything, because he is El Olam. When you think about El Olam, he knows everything from the beginning to the end, that he's always been around. He knew when we would have a problem. This God who has always been around, he knew back in eternity past when your problem was going to come. And when your problem came, it didn't take God by surprise, that God was not up in heaven saying, oh my, oh my, I didn't see this coming. He wasn't taken off guard. When your problem came, he wasn't up there scratching his head. God knew in eternity, wow, man. He knew in eternity past. And when was that? Again, the word Olam means hidden, right? It means that it's hidden from our understanding, that we can't understand eternity. There's no, you can't begin to grasp eternity with your mind. And so, way back then, whenever that was, he knew that your problem was coming. He knew that you were going to be having to deal with something that sometimes just upsets our whole life, that disrupts our whole being. And it didn't take him by surprise. And so for me, when problems come my way, the first thing I should say, El Olam knew about this a long time ago. And this, you know, it's not taking him by surprise. And therefore, I'm going to hold to God, his powerful hand. I'm going to let him take me through this time, because he was well aware of this situation before I was. He was well aware of your problem before you were even born. Can you think about that? Wow, before you were born, God knew when all your problems were going to happen. I tell you what, when I think about El Olam, the everlasting God, that encourages my faith. That strengthens my faith in the everlasting God, realizing that he knows all about me. He knows my life from the beginning to the end. He knows my life from the time that I was born until the time that I die, and how I will exist throughout eternity. What a mighty God we serve. You know what? He knows how our problems are going to end. He knows how our problems are going to end. They asked somebody, what's your favorite verse? And the person said, it came to pass. And they said, well, why is that your favorite verse? Because, praise God, it didn't come to stay. Whatever you are going through, God knows how it's going to end. He's already seen how this thing is going to end. It's like being in a train station. right? Where you've got trains coming in and you've got trains going out. You got trains coming in from several directions and you've got trains going out from several directions, right? And as if we were to stand on the deck and look at the train, we would just see it go by one car at a time. We would stand there and we would see the engine come by. We would see all the other cars come by and we would see the caboose come by. We would just see these things one at a time as they went before our eyes. But there's a conductor who's sitting up in the booth, and he's able, whether it's physically or even on a computer, he's able to see all these things coming and going, right? He doesn't see it one car at a time. He gets the big picture. And so when we think about El Olam, God does not see one car of our life at a time. Whew. My. He doesn't see one car of our life passing at a time, but he sees the big picture. And he knows the plans that he has for our lives. And watch this now. And he knows how he's going to get us from the start to the finish. He knows where we're going to start, and he knows how we're going to finish. He knows everything from the beginning to the end. There was a little boy who was in a building that was on fire, and smoke was coming out of the window that he was standing at. And the father was standing on the ground. And the father said, "Jump, son, jump." Because he knew that if his son didn't jump, he was going to burn up in the fire. He said, "Jump, son, jump." And the little boy said, "But dad, I can't see you." And the father said, "But I can see you. But I can see you." Sometimes God takes us through life, and we come to places, dry places, rough places, problem places in our life. And God tells us to jump. And we say, "God, I can't. I don't have the faith. I don't have the trust." And God says, "Jump." We say, "But God, I can't see you." And God says to us, "I am." Whew. He says to us, "I am El Olam. I'm the God of eternity past. I'm the God of eternity future. Go ahead and jump, because I see the beginning and I see the ending." And God just calls us to step out on faith and realize who he is, that he knows our beginning, that he knows our ending. And he says, "Just jump. Have faith. Trust me." And this is not a foolish faith. This is not a presumptuous faith, but this is a faith that's rooted and grounded in God. And God says, "Have faith. Trust me. And jump." El Olam. El Olam. He lives forever. And watch this. He keeps his promises. He lives forever and he keeps his promises. Listen to this. His mercy is everlasting. Psalm 100, verse 5. His truth is everlasting. Psalm 100 and verse 5. His covenants are everlasting. Psalm 105, verse 10. His righteousness is everlasting. Psalm 119, 142. His testimony is everlasting. Psalm 119, 144. His kingdom is everlasting. Psalm 145 and verse 13. God is the everlasting God. You know, you often think of judges, that a judge might sentence someone to a life sentence, right? And the person that they sentence to a life sentence, sometimes the judge will die while that person is still serving the life sentence. The judge will not see the person finish their life sentence. God, when he makes a decree, God, when he makes a judgment, God, when he gives mercy, when he gives grace, that he'll be around to see that it takes place. When you think of the fact that God made a promise that if you accept my son as your Lord and Savior, you will have eternal life. Now, just think, if God was not El Olam and he made that promise, right? And he said, well, I'm sending my son, you accept my son, and then you have eternal life. And then all of a sudden, God is off the scene. He's not around anymore, right? Then who's going to be the one that makes sure that promise continues on? Well, if God is the one who made it and he's not around anymore, now you see where I'm going. You might perish because there's nobody that's around that made the promise to make sure that the promise is going to be intact forever. But thank God, El Olam, he made the promise in that when he promises that we're going to have eternal life, woo, he's going to be around forever to make sure that it happens and that we have an inheritance that we can't lose because it was made by El Olam. I shared this story the other day on Bible study that there was a father who was very wealthy and he was about to die. And he called his son and he began to tell his son about this inheritance that he was going to receive when he died. And the son began to listen intently. And he went down point by point and told him what he was going to inherit. The son was sad that his father was about to pass away, but he knew that when his father passed away that he would receive a great inheritance. And so he went out and he began to just brag about what he was going to get. And he went to this one place and he saw a young lady there and he began to talk to her. And as he began to talk, you know, then now he wants to impress her, right? And so what do you think he did to impress her? He begins to tell her about the situation with his dad, with his father. And so he tells her about this situation and she listens. And he began to, you know, have some affection for this young lady and felt that this might be the beginning of a good relationship. And so, you know, he definitely got her number and looked forward to seeing her again. The next day he went over to check on his dad and the young lady was there. And his dad was lying on the bed and his dad said to the son, "Son, meet your new stepmom." He lost his inheritance, right? He lost his inheritance. And we thank God that God has made promises to us and that we'll never lose these promises that God has made to us because he'll always be around to make sure that these things stay intact. My mind goes back to the song that we opened with the spinners, right? I'll be around, right? Whenever you call me, I'll be there. Whenever you need me, I'll be there. Whenever you want me, I'll be there. I'll be around. You can't make a promise like that. How are you gonna make a promise like that? There might come a day when you're not around to fulfill that promise. Because you're not El Olam. You're not the everlasting God. But God makes that promise, and he can fulfill it. Let me close with this. And this is what I call, and I'm going to help somebody here, and I ask that you be patient, because I want to read some scripture. But as I read the scripture, I'm going somewhere. I'm talking about a new revelation. A new revelation. And maybe that's what you need this morning. You need a new revelation. Genesis chapter 21, verses 22 through 33. Let me read that to you. And it's talking about Abraham. And he made a covenant with a man by the name of Abimelech. And it says, at that time, Abimelech, accompanied by Phicol, the commander of his army, said to Abraham, God is with you in everything you do. Swear to me by God here and now that you will not break an agreement with me or with my children and descendants. As I have been loyal to you, you will be loyal to me and to the country where you are a resident alien. And Abraham said, I swear it. But Abraham complained to Abimelech because of the well of Abimelech's servants had seized. Abimelech replied, I don't know who did this thing. You didn't report anything to me, so I hadn't heard about it until today. Abraham took flocks and herds and gave them to Abimelech. And the two of them made a covenant. Abraham separated seven ewe lambs from the flock. And Abimelech said to Abraham, why have you separated these seven ewe lambs? He replied, you are to accept the seven ewe lambs from me so that this act will serve as a witness that I dug this well. Therefore, that place was called Beersheba because it was there that the two of them swore an oath. After they made a covenant at Beersheba, Abimelech and Phicol, the commander of the army, left and returned to the land of the Philistines. Verse 33. Oh, yeah. And Abraham planted a tamarisk tree in Beersheba. And there he called on the name of the Lord, the everlasting God. There he called on the name of the Lord, the everlasting God. What's that name? El Olam. There he called on El Olam. But you say, what's the big deal? I'm gonna help somebody out here. I'm gonna help somebody out here. What's the big deal? Because up until this point, Abraham knew God as El Elyon. Remember, God appeared to him earlier, and God appeared to him as El Elyon, God, the Most High God. Abraham knew him as El Shaddai, that before this point, God appeared to him and revealed himself as El Shaddai. But now, God is revealing himself to Abraham as El Olam. That Abraham was getting to know God in a way that he had not known up until this point. That he knew how to pray to El Elyon. He knew how to pray to El Shaddai. But God said, I'm revealing myself to you as El Olam, the God, the everlasting God. And maybe we've seen God's revelation in our lives. And we've seen God reveal himself as Yahweh Rapha, the God who heals. We've seen him reveal himself as Yahweh Jireh, the God who provides. We've seen him reveal himself as Yahweh Shalom, the God our peace. And we've got to know him in those ways. Today, why don't you get to know God by another one of his names, El Olam. And as I understand him as being El Olam, I realize that he knows the beginning and the end of everything that's going to happen in my life. And so when something comes into my life and I had no idea where it came from, that I can say El Olam knew all about this. I know him as El Olam. And I can also say that I know him as El Olam because he promised me that if I accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, that I have eternal life and that he's always going to be around to make sure that this life is always before me. And this life is one that I'll always have. And so get to know him as El Olam. And we thank God today for this El name of God. We've looked at El Elyon. We've looked at the God, the Most High God. We've looked at El Shaddai, the Almighty, All-Sufficient God. And today, we've looked at El Olam, God, the Everlasting God. Let us pray. Father, I come to you this morning, and we realize that there are some people out there that haven't connected with you as El Olam. And I pray today, Lord, that as we study this name of God, and as I said last week, somebody say, well, what's so important about the names of God? What's the big deal? Well, you know, why do we need to preach about the names of God? Why do we need to know the names of God? Well, I'll just say this, that God made a big deal out of it, right? God was the one who made the big deal. So if he made a big deal out of it, then I think we would be wise to get to know him by his names. And so, Lord, I pray today that you would help your people get to know you by El Olam, God, the everlasting God. That, again, Father, you know our lives from the beginning to the end. Nothing takes you by surprise. And, Lord, the promises that you made to us, that you'll always be around to make sure that they happen. Help us to connect with you in that light and hold on to this name, El Olam. Lord, I pray that if there's someone out there today that has never received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, that today they might open up their heart and ask Christ to come into their life. And if there's someone out there who would like to receive Christ, I'm going to ask that you would pray this prayer in your heart. Nothing magical about this prayer. Nothing mystical about this prayer, but it's the prayer that the Bible talks about in Romans chapter 10 and lets us know that if we pray this prayer and believe in our heart, that we shall be saved. And so, Lord Jesus, we come to you today. We thank you for dying on the cross for our sins. And right now, we ask you to come into our lives and be our Lord and Savior. Thank you for doing for me something that I couldn't do for myself, that you've saved me from my sin. And right now, you've given me eternal life. And I don't have to wait until I die, but I have eternal life right now from El Olam, the God of eternity. So thank you, Lord, for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen. And my friend, if you prayed that prayer, we want you to contact us here at Bethany Baptist Church, 412-242-3255, and we'll get some information in your hands to help you follow up on that decision that you have made. When you call, leave your name and how we can contact you, and we'll get the information that will help you follow up on this decision that you made today. Thank you for joining us, and we pray that God would bless you as you continue to worship El Olam.